Hello, everybody, and welcome to episode number 22 of I Wish You Were Dead, a podcast about things that used to be alive. My name is Mike. That is Gavin. Gavin, I don't know about you, but I am feeling our 22nd episode.
You're feeling 22? Is that what
I'm
you're
feeling
telling me
22.
Here?
Oh, I'm feeling 22 right now.
Oh, Mike.
Okay. All right. Did you really not expect that?
No, literally not at all.
I'm not gonna lie.
I'm feeling very much 25 right now. So
I've been planning that since like our third episode. Like if we make it to 22, I'm totally opening with that.
That's 100% believable. That's very in character for you.
Oh, it is absolutely in character. What's going on, buddy? Anything new? I heard you and your girlfriend did some hiking recently.
We did. She's here visiting me for a little bit before I move out from South Dakota back to New York. We made a little mini trip up to North Dakota. None of us have ever been up there. Shocker, I know. There's so much to do there. No offense to anybody that listens that lives in North Dakota, but I feel like that's a very small audience to begin with.
They're not.
But anyway, we went to Theodore Roosevelt National Park, which was super cool. We saw lots of bison. No buffalo, but we did see lots of bison. But we saw, let's see, what else did we see? There's lots of, we saw tons of prairie dogs too. They have like several prairie dog towns that were super, super cute. But yeah, so we stayed at just like this super weird hotel. We don't have time to go into how weird the hotel is, but like it was real cheap, but like not like bad cheap. Just like there's many just odd decisions that were made along the way for whoever made this hotel. Like, I just want to talk to them because I have so many questions. But anyway, for $57 a night, I'm not going to complain.
Nor should, and I wouldn't ask any more questions at that point.
Yeah, exactly. But it was a super, super cool trip just for a couple days. And then, she's here for about another week. And then we're going to do some, stereotypical touristy stuff. And yeah. But yeah, so that's what's been going on with me. What about you, Mike? What are you up to?
I mean, I wanted to ask what stereotypical touristy stuff there is to do in, South Dakota.
In this part of South Dakota, quite a lot, yeah.
Really?
Yeah, I mean, there's, like Badlands National Park. Within a couple hours, there's like Devil's Tower National Monument that we're going to go to. Just general sort of stuff like that. My parents are coming out and they're renting a U-Haul and helping me bring all my stuff back to New York. So I think the first full day they're here, we're going to Wind Cave National Park that none of us have ever been to. So there's another national park that's only about 20 minutes away, but I hadn't been to yet just because of COVID and because it's, a literal cave, they closed it. With most national parks, you can do most of what the park has, outside, but it's Wind Cave. So it's kind of hard to do that outside.
Right.
And then even in the before times, I believe their elevator was actually broken, so I couldn't even go then. So yeah, so I believe everything's working and that, people are allowed in with masks and such. So we're going to be planning on doing that, this coming weekend. So yeah, I'm pretty excited.
It sounds really exciting. And I'm glad you guys are finally able to spend quite a bit of time together. I know the whole distance thing kind of sucks. And so it is nice that you guys are together and you guys can, make fun of each other on Snapchat. In person.
Oh, thanks, buddy. We appreciate it. She can't hear you, but she appreciates it too.
Oh, I know she does. So we can go ahead. We're recording this a little bit later than normal, so we can go ahead and do our This Week in Science and then get right into it. So what do we? I'm gonna go with.
I want to change the policy a little bit here.
We're gonna change the policy. Okay, this was not
on your guessing, and this is totally up to you. I know you're having a rough go of guessing. We're 22 episodes deep. I think we've been doing this day in science for at least 15 episodes, probably, right?
I think even more than that.
Probably since like episode 2 or 3 anyway. But
I think so.
And you've yet to get one, so I will give the option to you. I'll give you plus or minus a year.
No, you can't. See, that's going to cheapen it. That cheapen
okay.
it. No, I reject okay. it. I either get it or I don't.
Okay, fair enough. What is your guess?
What I should do is I should just keep guessing the same year every time and just roll with that.
But, broken clock's right twice a day, so.
This is true, and if there's one thing that people call me, it's a broken clock. But I'm gonna go with 2016 for this week.
Unfortunate, no. 2019. So even with the plus or minus one, it wouldn't help. Right.
See, now you're just making me feel bad. This is doing the opposite of what you wanted. Or it maybe is, actually it's doing exactly what you wanted.
Anyway, what do we got? Yeah, so from May 13th, so the day this goes up, the day after, May 13th, 2019, moon quakes caused by moon's shrinking mass.
I have several questions, but continue.
I do as well, but well, this was the only one that was even like vaguely like geoscience or paleontology related, so here we are. So reports from the NASA Goddard Space Flight Center indicated that active faults within the Earth's moon may be responding to a gradual decline in the moon's total mass. That brings up way more questions than it answers.
Correct.
Specifically, the report said that the moon's diameter has shrunk by nearly 150 feet over the last several hundred million years, which like is very small, given that's a quite a long chunk of time. But anyway, and that readings from seismometers placed around the lunar surface indicate that lunar earthquakes, or moonquakes, are... I know, right? I don't know who coined that term, but I want to have words. Are increasing in frequency as this thinning process continues. Additionally, readings indicated that most moonquakes occur when the moon is furthest from the Earth, when increased gravity from Earth causes tidal stresses over the moon's surface. NASA also stated that future missions to the moon will have an increased emphasis on the lunar seismology and will look to fully understand the evolution of our moon over time.
Yeah, I mean, like, to quote Peter Griffin here, why are we not funding this? Like, there's the moon has active faults. Like, that's amazing.
So that's not inherently like surprising to me. Just because, like, yeah, most of like the earthquakes and things, I'd say most, but not all of the earthquakes on Earth are from like tectonic plates moving around, which obviously the moon does not have. But like just the shifting gravity, like it says, you know, the moon is what causes tides, right? But it's not like the moon is just pulling on the Earth. You know, the Earth pulls back. That's how gravity works. And so, you know, just that constant shifting of gravitational stress as the moon revolves around the Earth, I would say, yeah, that probably does cause, you know, over, you know, the timescales that we're talking about here, hundreds and, you know, actually with the moon, billions of years that it's been, you know, revolving around the Earth. Yeah, that would probably would cause lots of faults and stuff to form. So that doesn't surprise me. I'm surprised, frankly, that they have happened since we've been there, just because these are such huge timescales that we're talking about.
Right.
So I'm not surprised that they exist. I'm kind of surprised that they happen so frequently, it seems like.
That does make sense. Just the, if somebody wants to tell Bill O'Reilly that the moon causes tides, but also the Earth is pulling on the moon. I guess that does make some amount of sense, and just the faults that would come from that. Yeah, and I think that actually kind of leads us pretty well into our topic of the day when we're talking about geologic timescales, you know, whether we're talking about timescales of the moon or what's been happening here on Earth. I think that leads us pretty well into what it is, the topic that you've chosen for us today. So, Gavin, go ahead and take it away. What is it that we're going to be learning about today?
Yeah, so today we're going to be talking about fossils only sort of like indirectly, I guess, just because, you know, for the past 22 episodes, we've talked about, you know, things, you know, different parts of history, you know, things like the Cretaceous period. When I talked about my thesis, so I talked about the Miocene epoch, but we have yet to actually talk about what that means. We talked about it a bit in the first part of our 600 million years in 120 minutes, but we didn't
600 million years in two episodes. That might be
that's way better. Yeah, that's way better. But yeah, so we talked about it at the beginning of the first of those two episodes. And so, but not in super good detail. And like, realistically, if I was good at planning podcasts, this would have been like episode four, because this is so incredibly important. This is like what you spend the first, couple weeks learning about and stuff, in like freshman geology in college. So that's my bad. But that's what we're going to talk about today. So hopefully you're excited, because I'm pretty excited to talk about it, because it's, like I said, something that's like just so like foundationally important to geology that so many people don't understand. Frankly, because they have no reason to, realistically.
that's why we need more people to listen to this podcast.
Exactly. So tell your friends. we're going to go through a very brief, you know, obviously much more condensed than the 600 million years in two episodes, sort of very, very brief walkthrough of sort of the Earth's history. So we start off in the Hadean Eon, which is roughly 4.6 billion, you know, with a B, years ago. That's the Hadean Eon. That's pretty much characterized by the Earth being essentially hell. Like, everything's on fire. There's no liquid water. There's no oxygen in the atmosphere. It's all carbon dioxide and like poisonous acidic gas. The Earth just being completely bombarded by like meteorites and such. At one point,
if you had a time machine, you wouldn't want to go here.
Oh no, you would die almost instantly. At this point, I think around 4.3 or so billion years ago, a roughly Mars-sized planet hit the Earth, and then that became the Moon. That's the best hypothesis we have for how the Moon got there. So,
right.
Speaking of the Moon, so that goes into, that is the first eon of our planet. That is the largest time scale we have, is called an eon. After that, we get into the Archean Eon, which is the first time that we see any kind of fossils. You know, at this point, it's all still strictly single-celled life. Most of it comes in the way of things like stromatolites, which are sort of these mounds of not actual fossils, but like things that form because of the way the bacteria sort of sat in these mats, like sediment sort of collects on them. And then the bacteria sort of move up through the sediment and basically makes like a big mound type shape. So we have indirect fossils and things like that through the Archean. After that, but that's still an eon. We're still at the sort of the large scale eon stage. So that goes until about 2.5 billion years ago, when we get to the Proterozoic Eon. And that goes from about, like I said, 2.5 billion to only about 554 million. So that's about a 2 billion year chunk of time, roughly half of Earth's history. And we're literally just breezing through it because, frankly, as we'll talk about, not a lot of things happen. But that's not because they didn't actually happen. It's because we can't see them. But we'll get more into that. During this time, we see the very first sort of things that you can kind of point at and be like, I think that's an animal. I think, maybe. And then after that, but that's still an eon. We're still the largest chunk scale of time that we have. Mm-hmm. After that, we move into the current eon that we are currently in, called the Phanerozoic. Right. And because at this point we have so much data that we can work with, we can actually start to break that down a little further into what people would call eras, medium large chunks of time. And of course, you know, things like the Archean and the Proterozoic do have smaller subdivisions, but you know, for the sake of the argument of this episode, we'll not talk about those. So the first era of the Phanerozoic, so the medium large chunk of time, is the Paleozoic era. That means, you know, paleo meaning old, zoic meaning life. The first time we see like complex life. We've talked about it a bit before with like the Cambrian period, the Cambrian explosion, Ordovician mm-hmm. period, Silurian period, Devonian period, Carboniferous period, Permian period, sort of in order from oldest to youngest. And that also sort of brings in our next smallest chunk of time, sort of the medium small chunk of time called a period. Most people are pretty familiar with those. That's mostly what people talk about when they talk about geologic time periods, you know, Cretaceous period and such. After that, we move into the Mesozoic middle life era, and we get the three periods that most people are probably most familiar with: the Triassic period, the Jurassic period, and the Cretaceous period. So that the Cretaceous period is the final period of the Mesozoic. Then we get into the Cenozoic, which means recent life. And there's only three periods within the Cenozoic. There's the Paleogene, the Neogene, and the Quaternary, which is now. However, once we get to some of these later time periods, mostly in the Cenozoic, it becomes more useful just because, once again, we have so much more data to work with and so much better, you know, more rocks, more fossils. It just becomes more useful to talk about some of the smaller subdivisions. So within the Paleogene, you much more often hear the epochs, which is not like the smallest slice of time, but it's the smallest one that most people deal with on a regular basis. So then with the Cenozoic, you get the Paleocene, which is confusing, you know, Paleocene, Paleogene, but this, the scene is smaller. So we get the Paleocene, Eocene, Oligocene, Miocene, the time period that I study, Pliocene, Pleistocene, and Holocene throughout the Cenozoic. So those are called epochs. Small. So we have going from largest to smallest, eon, era, period, epoch.
Now, quick question. In each of these, as we're naming each eon, era, period, and epoch, and this just crossed my mind as you were going through the different epochs, do they all have the same suffix, like in each one, like each epoch has the same suffix and each period has the same suffix, or did I put too much into that?
Typically, no. It's mostly just that we scientists aren't the most creative bunch. We typically just like to reuse suffixes and prefixes for things. Just because it kind of makes things a little simple. So for example, the like scene suffix, C-E-N-E, I believe means recent. And so you get things like the Paleocene, which means old recent. So it's like the oldest part of the most recent era.
Right.
So
really modern. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. And then you get a lot of really complicated things when we're talking about stuff. So there's like the late early Miocene. Or the early late Miocene, which are not the same. And there's lots of that goes on. It's mostly just getting used to it at that point. Some of just the nomenclature. Right. But yeah, so that is the briefest walk through the last 4.6 billion years of Earth history.
And that has brought us up to now.
Pretty much, yeah. So we are currently, although debatable, in the Holocene epoch that is now. Within the Quaternary period, within the Cenozoic era, within the Phanerozoic eon. So that is where we are at right now. So you think, you know, everyone knows, you know, that the end of the Cretaceous was 60, most people think 65, but 66 million years ago. But how do you think, Mike, we actually determine where... each of these slices starts and stops?
Yeah, normally when you ask me these kinds of questions, I can at least kind of suss it out. I mean, so part of me wants to say, because I'm assuming there's different answers depending on what are we talking about in eon, era, period, or epoch. So I'm
right.
Maybe this actually helps me out, is that I can just kind of luck into getting one. I'm going to... I want to say like mass extinction events would probably be one, but I feel like we've talked about at least one or two mass extinctions that actually kind of like straddles a line instead of being the beginning or the end of one. I am going to say, just based on like, you know, knowing you mostly, that it's like at least one of the kind of dividing lines that we'll see is like when particular animals either start or stop showing up. And it might be sort of an arbitrary thing which animals we choose, but, you know, we've picked, you know, animal X and it starts showing up at this time and it stops showing up at that time. And we are calling that, you know, the whatever period. So that's what I'm going with. That's what I'm sticking with. Tell me what the real answer is.
So this was a little bit of a trick question. You did, honestly, everything you said was broadly true.
Okay.
However, I will say, for example, the Cretaceous ends at 66 million years because that's where we said it ends.
Okay.
Realistically, like it is because of those things that you said, you know, we have evidence for that mass extinction there, but it's not like the Earth was like, okay, I'm entering a new phase. You know, I'm entering my college phase, right? It's not like the Earth was, you know, everything on the Earth suddenly changed to be like, I'm now in the Cenozoic, you know, I'm now new life, your recent life. And it's not like that's a thing that exactly happened at a specific time. Each boundary is where it is because, frankly, we said it's there.
Right, but they're not like totally arbitrary. It's not like we had to draw a line somewhere and we were like, all right, there's fine. Like, we had to draw a line somewhere. So, like, there are, you know, like, the difference between 65 million years ago and 65 million 1 years ago, like, isn't that great. But, like, there's a reason the line is drawn there, correct?
There is. And, even though, like I said, I have since... Oh, also, by the way, my graduation was this past Saturday. So I'm now officially a master. Forgot to mention that. Yeah, so. Yes,
congratulations. So we have two masters, two master's degrees on this podcast now.
But yeah, so I have a master's degree in paleontology. And even until like relatively recently, like within the last probably year and a half or so, this was still a little confusing to me as for like how exactly, you know.
Right.
There are even further subdivisions. You know, there are things called ages as well, which is just another smaller subdivision. Mm-hmm. But those are really only talked about in, like, super fine detail, generally. But, so how we sort of established these was kind of a mystery to me, just because I'm not a stratigrapher, which is somebody who studies, you know, layers of sedimentary rocks and things. That's just... typically not what I do. You know, I've taken a couple classes in it. I TA'd, you know, sedimentary geology and stratigraphy for a semester, but that's not typically what I spend my time doing. So how this whole process of how we figure this out has always been a little bit of a mystery to me until relatively recently. But as you've sort of, you know, laid out in a layman's way, rocks are basically what we use. As much as I, being a fossil person, would like to say that it's all fossils, unfortunately, that's not true. so rocks, essentially, are like a book. And the best sort of analogy that I've had it laid out for me is if anyone's ever been to the Grand Canyon, or I'm sure most people have probably seen a picture of the Grand Canyon.
If not, you can look it up. It's pretty simple.
Right. And it's literally just all these beautiful layers and layers of different colored rocks, one on top of the other, basically horizontal. And if you understand geology, and especially like sedimentary geology, then you can sort of read that like a book, starting from the older rocks at the bottom and going to younger rocks at the top. And something that I think a lot of people sort of miss is that, you know, if you are sort of like vaguely in the world of paleontology, where it's like, you know, you might watch like a TV show about it every now and then, and you're like, oh, this particular animal lived in swamps, and it's like, oh, okay, the reason we know that isn't usually something about the fossil itself. It's actually the rocks that tell us that,
because it's rocks where the fossil was found,
right? Because, you know, short of finding something with like flippers where it's like, okay, this clearly lived in the water, it can be kind of hard to tell just by looking at something, especially things that we don't have modern analogs of today. Things like, you know, dinosaurs, you know, we don't have great analogs for those, or things even older than dinosaurs. We don't have great analogs, or, you know, things that are really closely related to them, to just sort of look at what their relatives do and figure out from that what they did. So mostly we know that, you know, some of like the big, you know, mammal ancestors that lived in the Permian period, we know that they are like desert dwelling animals, not because of anything about the way that they're shaped or anything, but because of the rocks that they were found in. So the rocks tell us much, much more about the environment than the animals really do.
That actually makes a lot of sense. The fossil itself, I assume, tells you quite a bit about the animal, but where that fossil is found is going to tell you way more about like what's going on around that animal and what kind of
exactly
animal. like that makes a ton of sense.
And like, obviously there are some exceptions, you know, things like
coral. Crossover.
Well, things like corals have, even way back in the day, you know, ancient corals, we can pretty safely assume that like they have very specific, you know, temperature ranges that they can live in. You know, there's a reason why there's not, you know, coral reefs off the coast of like Maine or something. You know, corals don't typically like cold water. There are some cold water corals, but you don't see like the big reef building ones. So we can pretty much, if you see a place where there's coral, you can infer some things about that environment, even if you didn't have any rocks. But by and large, it is almost always the rocks that tell you what the environment was like. And the big thing that determines, and I guess you sort of got to this to sort of like a roundabout way, but the big thing that determines all of these subdivisions in time are environmental changes. You know, really clear, really, you know, we can see, you know, at somewhere in this zone, there's a transition in this particular, you know, piece, you know, sequence of rocks where it's like, you know, here used to have, you know, a swampy place, and then it sort of turns more into a beach, and then it turns into more a reef environment, and then it turns into like a really deep ocean. You can see those transitions in the rocks, and it's like, okay, what does that tell us about what was going on, A, in this spot, but also sort of globally?
Right.
And the biggest thing is, okay, so in this particular spot, say somewhere in central New York, you see a transition from a more swampy place to that, all the way through to that like deep ocean. Is that happening everywhere, or is that just happening here? Because if it's just happening here, that might not be such a big thing. You know, sometimes you'll get, you know, sea levels can change for a variety of reasons that don't necessarily need to be a global thing happening. And did you have something?
I was going to say, so is it the point being like, if something's happening on a small scale or in kind of one localized area that like might be of interest to people that are studying that area or organisms from that area, mm-hmm. but it, like, we're not going to be naming, you know, different geologic, you know, time scales after it. But exactly. if we can say that it's happening over a much larger, you know, I don't know, much larger tract of land or much larger area, then at that point, you know, at some point, a difference in amount becomes a difference in kind, and mm-hmm. you have to start taking note of that.
Yeah, definitely. And so you can really easily track these transitions in environments, or to a sedimentary geology person, that'd be called a facies, which is basically just, you know, a segment, a section of rock from a particular environment. You know, you have your, you know, desert facies, which all have a handful of, you know, characteristic things. You have your swamp facies that all have, you know, their own separate characteristic things. And so you can track the changes in, you know, these facies sequences and sort of figure out, okay, here it's going from swamp to like beachy area. This other area, you know, hundreds and hundreds of miles away, also kind of go from maybe not necessarily from a swamp to that, but maybe from, you know, a beach to deeper ocean, you know, also sort of showing, you know, an increase in sea levels. Not, maybe not necessarily the same kind of increase, because, you know, obviously different environments are different in different places. But if you see at roughly the same time a sea level change or something to that effect, I just kind of use that because that's a simple analogy. Mm-hmm. But then you might have something globally going on. But it's not, again, not just the rocks, because how do you know, to begin with, that those two places are from the same time? They could be totally different time. It's not like, you know, the rocks have written on them, I am from the Cretaceous period. I am from, you know, the Permian period. It's not like, you know, if someone were to hand me a rock, I would have no idea when that was from.
Isn't this where we use like different fossils? Like, we know that this organism was alive from this time to this time. And so if we see this organism in its layer of rock, we can, you know, kind of put a ballpark estimate on it.
Absolutely. That is absolutely perfect. How we do it.
Awesome. I feel smart.
As you should, you're learning. That was the whole point of this podcast, was for me to nerd out about fun science things for you and for you to geek out and learn with me. So that's fun.
You know the meme, like Stonks guy?
Oh, of course I do.
Stonks. I feel like, you know, doing that, but like having me holding a test tube that just says like Skyence or something.
We should make that someday. That'd be awesome.
Yes, please. Yes, please.
But yeah, that's pretty much how we do it. Is, okay, we know these fossils, usually it's an invertebrate. Very rarely do we use vertebrates for this kind of thing, just because these are fossils called index fossils. Basically, they're fossils that meet a handful of criteria. Basically, they are very widespread, found basically across the entire world. Or at least at very, very large regions where they could overlap with other things covering very, very large regions.
Mm-hmm.
They have to be very abundant, so they can't just be like very widespread, but relatively rare. You know, if you think of, you know, things like mountain lions. Mountain lions are very, very widespread. You can find them from like, you know, the Rocky Mountains in Canada all the way down to like southern South America. Very widespread, but they're pretty rare. You don't typically see them. Even, you know, before humans came in and screwed up North America, they weren't all that common. So they need to be widespread, they need to be really common, and they need to fossilize well, which means mostly that it's things with really hard shells, typically things like clams, things like ammonites when they were around, you know, those, as I refer to them lovingly in the past, the swirly shelled squid boys. or even very commonly we use almost microscopic things, where it's like if you saw one in the water, you might be able to be like, huh, what's this weird speck in the water? You'd be able to see it, but not really make it out. We typically use things called foraminifera, small, like single-celled things that tend to just kind of hang out in the water. But the most important thing about index fossils is that each species is only around for a very short amount of time, and a very specific amount of time. So you know, if you have this one species of clam, let's say, you know you're within a time span of like a million years. If you find it anywhere in the world, you're only in the same million years, no matter where you find it.
And at that point, I assume you can start looking at the rocks around it and seeing if there's any like common threads that are happening, you know, in the environment worldwide, I guess.
Yeah, absolutely. That's more or less how they do it. However, something that we also kind of fall into the trap of a lot in geology, and I think a lot of people in general do this without sort of thinking of it, but in geology it can be particularly difficult to sort of get around, is let me put you through a little hypothetical here.
Oh boy.
So you come up to me with a fossil of let's say one of the horses that I work with, a tooth of a horse called Pliohippus. We've talked about it before on the podcast.
Mm-hmm.
You come up to me with a Pliohippus tooth and you say, what is this? And I say, well, this is a Pliohippus tooth from, you know, the late Miocene. And you're like, okay, well, how do you know that it's from the late Miocene? Well, because it's Pliohippus.
Right.
And so do you get caught in that loop? Is that you know that it's from the late Miocene because it's Pliohippus. But you know it's Pliohippus because it's from the late Miocene.
So this is where you're relying on, you know, all the people that came before you. Like, hopefully they did their work.
But you also have to be able to, as a good scientist, be able to figure out if someone didn't do that good work beforehand.
Right.
To be able to catch their circular reasoning that they fell into in the past. So for that, that's when we use two different dating methods. And in reality, this is simplifying it way down.
Can I guess?
You sure can.
Tinder and Bumble.
Unfortunately, no. The answers were Hinge and Plenty of Fish. No. So.
Is carbon dating one of them?
That is a subsection of one of them.
Okay.
We'll get there.
I'm out at that point.
Yeah, we'll get there. We will talk about it. So this might sort of surprise people what I'm going to talk about here. So geology sort of mainly got its start in like the 1600s, you know, in sort of like the Renaissance-ish period. I don't even, is that the, you're the history person. Is that like Renaissance-ish?
Say it again.
Like that's like 1600s-ish?
For the Renaissance?
I feel like that's like after Renaissance, like post-Renaissance stuff.
Gonna be honest, never taught it. Don't have a clue. Can't even spell it as I'm looking it up now. So you okay. Go ahead. I will. But
sometime in like mid-ish 1600s is when modern geology sort of first got its start. Obviously, people like Aristotle, who were just real good at thinking about stuff because they didn't have anything else to do. You know, they started classifying
about like 1400s, 1500s. A little bit into the 1600s.
Yeah, probably on like the tail end of the Renaissance, I would think. Sure. But yeah, it sort of got its main start somewhere in the 1600s with people sort of being like, okay, this rock on the bottom. And there's actually a very famous geologist who everyone who's taken like a freshman geology class should know. His name is Steno. He has the sort of main print, like absolute, you know, 101 level foundational levels of geology, principles named after him, Steno's principles, basically saying, hey, that rock on the bottom, that's older than the one on the top. Which at the time, everyone was like, whoa.
Did he receive any pushback on this, or was it was he able to get acceptance pretty straight away?
I mean, once it's pointed out, like, it's kind of common sense, right? Where it's like, okay, if you dump sand on top of something, that's going to be on top of it. Kind of, right?
Right.
But it's like, okay, once it's pointed out and spelled out to you, like, yeah, okay, that actually makes a lot of sense. But he has lots of other, you know, Steno's principles are pretty, there's quite a few of them. Basically, like, that the old stuff is on the bottom, newer stuff's on the top. At least sedimentary rocks, not so much igneous metamorphic rocks, but sedimentary rocks are laid out horizontally, at least at first. They can be messed with later to be funky. And basically, if you have sort of a, say you have like a big tube of lava that comes through it, that cuts through the layers of sedimentary rocks, that happened after the sedimentary rocks were deposited.
Right. It's got to be able to cut through something.
Exactly. You know, you can't
cut through. Yeah,
exactly. You can't cut through something that's not there. Again, things that make very basic common sense, but until somebody wrote them down, you know, that's science. So, so that was like 1600s-ish. However, and this is the part that I said might blow some people's minds. Up until like the 1900s, like the early 1900s, we never had numbers to these time periods. A lot of these time periods were named in like the 1800s. Some of them named in like the late 1700s or so. They never had numbers with them. They kind of speculated, but they didn't really have the technology or frankly the data to actually be able to put numbers to these boundaries that they were creating. They just would say, okay, the Cretaceous is before the Paleogene, which is before the Neogene, which is before the Quaternary. They just put things in order based on the fossils, based on the facies changes, the environment changes that they were seeing. And doing that all across the planet, you know, as, you know, people, you know, science and scientists were becoming more widespread, because as with most things that we talk about in science, it was pretty Eurocentric, frankly, or at least that's the model that we currently use for a variety of reasons that we're not going to get into here. But so up until basically 100 years ago, we had no idea exactly how many million years ago the Cretaceous period ended. No idea.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
So we knew that it existed, but we didn't know when it ended.
Right. We knew where the boundary was. We knew when it started, or where we knew where it started. We knew we could find the boundary, between the Jurassic and the Cretaceous. We had the evidence for there being a boundary there. We had the evidence for a boundary at the end of it. But we had no way to put actual literal numbers to those dates. And I really, I tried really hard before, like in, you know, writing the, you know, notes for this episode to find, cause I've seen one in one of my classes, like an old geologic timescale from like the '70s. And it was so wildly wrong. Like even as far back as only like 50 years ago. Like I think like they had like the Triassic, which, I have the, you know, the most recently published, geologic timescale up. The Triassic starts 251.9 million years ago. I think they had it at like less than 100. Don't quote me directly on that, but so it's the, like
it, they were off by quite a bit, and like not their fault, but it
exactly. But so everything they were doing before we put the numbers to it was called relative dating. And as I heard on another podcast, this is where every freshman geology teacher inserts Alabama joke here. Relative dating.
I had one in mind. I was gonna hold on to that one, but you know what? I'm glad you did it for me.
Oh, of course. I'm always going to make that joke.
Cue Leonard Skinner.
Okay, moving on. But yeah, so it is relative in that it is, you're saying, okay, this thing is older than this other thing based on the fossils, the environment changes that you're seeing. You can do that completely without, you know, dates, without actual numbers. Basically, you do it in the same way that you sort of would organize. So if you have like a bunch of numbered puzzle pieces, you put them in order relative to the other ones. You sort of see what I mean there?
I don't have a clue what you're talking about. Numbered puzzle pieces?
Yeah, so if you had like, you know, or I guess we'll just say blocks. If you had like blocks with a number on them, you just start putting them in order based on like the, what, or I guess we'll take the numbers out of it. If you had like colored blocks and you start putting them in, you know, the order of the rainbow, you put them in the order, you know, that, you know, it's like, okay, it goes red, then orange, then yellow, then green, then blue, then violet. You put them in order relative to the ones around it.
I was going to kind of compare it too. Did you ever play the game when you were a kid? We did this in like middle school gym class all the time, where you had to, like, without talking, you had to figure, like, put yourselves in like birth order, like throughout the year.
Yeah, so, no, that's like, that's a really good analogy.
Right. And so it, as long as you do that correctly, I can look at that order and I can see, okay, you know, I can tell who was born first and who was born last, but I don't know who was born on any specific date.
Yeah, or another, you know, popular sort of like middle school thing is like lining people up by height.
Yeah, where that's, it's like, that's actually a really good comparison.
Right, it's like, okay, you fit in between these two. You know, you're putting people in order relative to the people around them.
Right.
Not based on, you know, you could actually measure, but if you were just doing it quickly, just by like visual height, you would just sort of look at the stuff that you, the data you already have, being the people already like in line, you take your new data, a new person that you're trying to fit into this line, and fit it where it fits best within that pre-existing line. That's basically how they did it, except, you know, with fossils and science. And so that is relative dating. Putting things just in order based on the transitional fossils and transitional environments that we see. When we started actually being able to put numbers to things, that's called absolute dating, because you actually have numbers that you can use to back that up.
This is taking the tape measure out and seeing exactly how tall you are.
Exactly. And this is where carbon dating sort of fits. That is the most common one that most people sort of think of. So carbon dating is a form of radiometric dating, basically using radioactive elements. Because for, I think, I don't want to say all, but most radioactive elements that occur in nature, where we know their half-life. So if you have like a pound of it, you know, radioactive things, just by the nature of being radioactive, turn into something else.
Right.
So if you have 1 pound of carbon, you know, radioactive carbon, which is carbon 14, it will decay into half a pound of radioactive carbon at a specific time. I think it's 5,000 years and some change. And, you know, after that, it will turn into a quarter pound. You know, it will half itself again after another 5,000 and some change years.
Mm-hmm.
So for most radioactive elements, we know their half-life. So based right. on that, if you have a sample that has this radioactive stuff in it, then you can figure out exactly when that's from. And like I said, carbon dating is the most well-known one. That's really only useful for, I think some people have been able to push it back to about 60,000 years. But that's about as far back as that's actually usable, just because carbon-14's half-life is relatively short.
Right.
You know, after, I think...
At some point, there's just not enough carbon left to actually date the thing. You can tell it's older right. than, you know,
yes,
60,000
exactly.
years or whatever the case might be, but yep. that's about it.
Right. So some of the more useful ones for longer term, you know, obviously, like, carbon dating is extremely useful for things within that 60,000 years, because you can get almost, like, to within a year. Usually, it's usually like plus or minus, you know, 1 or 2 years with carbon dating, especially with relatively recent stuff. Once you get close to like that 60,000 or so boundary, it gets a little fuzzier with like the error bars. But if you're doing things from like 12, 15,000 years ago, you can get easily within like decade scale with carbon dating. It's really good. But when it gets to longer time scales, you have to use things like uranium, which is, you know, a really good one. Or sometimes there's a radioactive form of potassium as well that you can use. But that all depends on your sample having it. You know, if you're just in like a regular sandstone from a beach, well, chances are there's probably not a ton of uranium just chilling at the beach. So sometimes you don't always have that. So basically how we do a lot of, you know, geologic timescale things is a combination of relative and absolute dating. For example, one of the best fossil sites in the Great Plains that I think we've also talked about on the podcast is Ashfall Fossil Beds in northern Ashfall Nebraska.
Fossil Beds.
I believe you actually looked it up like live on the podcast, and it was you thought Did it was I? Very cool. Yeah, it's basically the story of like Ashfall Fossil Beds is sometime in the Miocene, and there is an actual, you know, literal date to it, because it is a, as you might assume, an ashfall, you know, a volcano somewhere in the Rockies erupted and dumped a bunch of volcanic ash, which typically does have quite a lot of, you know, radioactive elements in it. And it buried a bunch of these fossils, basically Pompeii'd them, I think is sort of what we talked about with that. And so, you know, millions of years later, humans come along and come across these fossils, and we can figure out we can take samples from that ash and get a radiometric absolute date on it. And then my site that I worked on for my thesis, which did not have, you know, any sort of radiometrically dateable things, I can basically see, okay, we know the general trend of, say, horse evolution from the time that ashfall was deposited, when all that ash fell, to today. So if we look at the horses at my site, which, again, did not have anything that we can do this absolute dating on, we can sort of see how far along the horses are between then and today, which is relative dating. Is this sort of making sense?
I think so, yeah. Because are you trying to say, like, use like a combination of both the relative and absolute dating?
Yeah, yeah. That's
in order to place things where they need to be.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. And yeah. For a lot of the boundaries, it kind of depends, you know, between obviously for things like the boundary at the end of the Cretaceous, we have a really big marker for that one. You know, the big asteroid that hit the planet, you know, spat up a bunch of ash. That is very, you might have heard of that one. But that spat up a bunch of ash that can be radiometrically dated. And while we've talked about how we might not have fossils from the latest Cretaceous all over the world, we do have sediments in quite a few places, especially like marine sediments. And so you can find this layer in many places across the world, and you can get a date from that layer. And if you test it using a variety of methods, you know, usually you really hope that there's multiple radioactive elements in your sample so that you can date each of them. And hopefully the dates line up, because if they don't, then you have a problem. but if you have, you know, a uranium date from that site that says 66 million years ago, and you have a potassium date from that site, that same sample that also says 66 plus or minus a few from that same site, you're like, okay, I feel pretty good about it. And then based on that, based on those really nice events, you sort of hang other fossil sites or things off of those good events that we do have.
Yeah, I mean, that makes, you know, that makes total sense. You take the markers you do have, and then you're able to kind of place things in order after that. And you should be able to get a pretty decent, you know, a pretty decent timeline, especially, you know, if you're off by, correct me if I'm wrong, if you're off by, you know, a couple of million years, like, that's not the biggest deal in the world at the timescales we're talking about.
Well, so I will say, like I said, I have the Geologic timescale, the most recently published one, open in front of me here. And it looks like, obviously, the farther back in time you go, the bigger the error bars are going to be. Just because, you know, you have, you know, more chances for things like sampling error, or things like a little bit of like contamination, or different effects that can just increase the variability in your sample. But it looks like the first time that we have a plus or minus of over a million years is all the way back in the Jurassic. So the first one I see is at 157 million years ago. And that one's plus or minus 1 million years.
Wow. So what you're saying is that scientists have gotten pretty good at this whole figuring out how old things are?
Yeah, it's pretty good. You know, even ones in the Cretaceous. I think the largest one that I see in the Cretaceous is plus or minus half a million years.
That's amazing. That really is.
It really is. Like, it's come super, super far. Even just in the time that I've been learning about science. You know, they publish a new one of these pretty much every year. And I still remember, I think the first one that I sort of looked at back in, I think it was like my sophomore year of college. So it'd be like 2015, I think. Mm-hmm. I think back then, I think it was the Cretaceous ended 65.5 million years ago. So even since then, they've changed it. And it will, at this point, our data are so good that it won't change all that much.
Right.
But even on this timescale, there is not a plus or minus on that date anymore. We're so confident with it that we just took the error bar off it. We are very positive that it is 66.0 million years ago is when that happened. And even as far back as, I think the largest error bars that I'm seeing on here at all are about 3 million years, plus or minus. And there are ones even after that that are smaller. You know, we have ones all the way back in like 450-ish million years ago that are plus or minus 0.7 million years. Which is, again, absolutely incredible. You know, science has come so far.
It really does blow my mind, and it kind of goes back to, you know, it sort of brings back to what you were saying at the beginning, where, you know, these time period, I'm going to say time periods just as a generic term, you know, these time periods, you know, they are where we say they are, but they're there for a reason. And, you know, with all of the different, you know, methods that are used between, you know, relative and absolute dating and, you know, the archaeology and paleontology, like, you know, being able to find all, I shouldn't say archaeology, paleontology. I really got to stop doing that.
That's okay. I wasn't going to say anything.
I co-host a podcast about this stuff. You'd think I'd get the point. But between all the different disciplines and different methods that are used, like, it, you know, yes, it's true that these boundaries are where we say they are, but damn if there's not some good reasons behind, you know, where they are.
Yeah. And so each, and I actually didn't know this also until relatively recently. So each boundary has what's called a GSSP, which at one point I knew what that stood for, but it has since left my brain. This isn't in the notes. It's just kind of off my noggin. But it is essentially...
It's not very pronounceable. GISP.
Yeah, it is basically the spot where that boundary is.
Global boundary, stratotype, section, and point?
Yes, that.
Okay.
So basically, they take a spike, a literal like nail, and put it somewhere in the world on where that boundary is. Frankly, that part actually is relatively arbitrary. You know, we talked about it before.
That seems performative.
Right. But it is important because that is sort of, you know, as we've talked about before, where every time you publish a new species, you need a type fossil for it, saying this is the one that, and anything else that you think might be this species, this is the one to compare it to.
Right.
You also need that for each slice. They mostly do that for the really small slices, things like ages, which are on the scales of, you know, a handful of millions of years, as opposed to, you know, the Cretaceous period, which lasted for like almost 100 million years, like I think 80 or so.
I totally get the needing to have like a, you know, one thing that everything else is defined against. It's the taking an actual physical spike and driving it into the earth. Like, that's like, that seems like you're, you know, we're doing this for pictures, but maybe that's just me.
Yeah. To be honest, I don't know exactly why they do that in particular. It is just the way it's done. I had it explained to me, in my, class that I learned about it in, basically sort of like, you know, with it being kind of arbitrary. So if you sort of take a person where it's like, okay, you know, a child when you see one, you know, an adult when you see one, where is the line? Obviously, for like legal reasons, you know, by law there is like a line, but it's like if you were to line up a bunch of people in a row, it's kind of tough to draw a line between like child, teenager, adult.
Right, but you got to draw a line somewhere.
And so for the most part, it is relatively arbitrary where the physical location for each thing is. But the data are there to support wherever they do it. They try to do it in as much of a quantitative, you know, numerical way as they possibly can. But in paleontology, sometimes you just kind of can't escape that. Sometimes you just don't have good enough data, and that you just kind of got to pick a point sometimes.
And that's, you know, when somebody says, where do you draw the line? Sometimes the answer is somewhere.
Exactly. Yeah. You just kind of go wherever feels right, wherever the nail strikes the rock.
Exactly. So does that about wrap it up for our geologic periods? And I guess a little bit of dating in this episode. Does that about wrap it up?
Yeah, I think so. You know, this is something I've kind of wanted to talk about for a little while, just because it is so like fundamentally important to geology. Just because, like I said, you know, at the very beginning, I have been rifling off all of these, you know, different names of different periods and things, you know, for 22 episodes now. And I haven't actually taken time to be like, okay, here's what this actually means, and here's how we actually know it means that. So yeah, this was really nice.
And I enjoyed it quite a bit, and I hope that all of you listening out there at home, driving in your car, wherever you might be, I hope all of you enjoyed it as well. This has been episode 22 of I Wish You Were Dead, a podcast about things that used to be alive. This podcast is currently in its, I guess we're in our third decade of making episodes, going from 21 to 30.
Yeah.
But this has been episode number 22 of I Wish You Were Dead, a podcast about things that used to be alive. Thank you very much, Gavin, and we'll see you next week.